we are fat with the wattles of excess. Running a cool hand across my shoulder, I shudder, not unpleasantly, in the lukewarm breeze blowing from the ocean. It's hard to even think of that word, ocean. Gazing upon the rough, scarred skin of my hand, I remember the basin of cold water that had cooled it, not more than a few minutes ago. Those scars tell the story we are forcing ourselves to forget. A story whose verses, letters, and songs claw at our throats like rivers of sand, pushing against the cliffs of our newly erected social structures. The ocean, here on Black 4, is the ocean of dreams. The water, oh, it's beautiful water which even now brings a shudder of ecstasy to the small of my back. Ice cold, remembering its mountain source. Black 4 are much the same. Timid, aloof, cold, easygoing. Nearly 10 years ago, they invited us here to stay. They have enough land, they said. They have enough water, they said. They would welcome us. And, as eager children, newcomers to the heart's embrace, we gladly accepted. But we grow fat with the waters of excess. I see it in my people's eyes. I hear their well-disguised sighs. They miss the desert. Tempered within its horrible crucible, they know not what to do without it. Our terrible social muscles, the tendons and ligaments of family, drive and hold, move and coil beneath the skin we have sewn for ourselves. Clothed in galactic customs, shrouded in the worlds which we have forced ourselves to don, we ache. We remember our home and we ache. We remember our suffering. We feel the rough maps of our scars and we cry for return. But there is no return. Bow, they say. Drink deep of the water you have been given, they say. Rejoice, for we are the sisterhood of men. Eternal, they say. And we murmur and nod our heads and drink deep of the water we have been given. But we grow fat on these, the waters of excess, and I've had enough. I reach across with my hand, firmly grasping the crimson sash, and fasten it across my breast. Only then is the armor donned by my closest guard. I smile faintly at her, brushing away that strand of hair I love so. With a tight expression, she harshly tightens the last strand. Yes, this is who we are. Hot, harsh, scarred, leather, sand. Sand piling into the room, into the street below. We are fat with the water of excess. It is time to bring the desert back. I thought I had smelled you, and so my heart reached out. But you weren't there, just a trick of my scent. And so, my heart was left hanging out, stretching towards my surroundings, so vain, intending. It found humanity, and suddenly, I was intensely aware of them. Humans. Like all of a sudden feeling the company of an animal in a forest clearing. Humans. Gorgeous, supple, warm, alien humans all around me. Was it fear I felt? No. For once? No. It was just an awareness. A milky film of a feeling around the edge of my skin.
The cool breeze slightly comforting my body palm. Nothing much, just that. A thin picking up of my heartbeat. A murmuring of smile. A coaxing of voices. A smattering of everything.
Death of But now, by some miracle of an emotional physicality, I am open. I hear the noise of the ships going to the rings, and I am filled with a strange pride. We have accomplished so much. Begin my new life. It's time to finally enter the city. I pick up my things and head for the stairs. The handle near the door is cold under my fingers. I turn the handle and I'm in Amare Usque Admare, her sister. I turn the handle and I'm in Cor Ad Cor Lucritur, my bright sister. And my heart is still so vain.
Pierres, the moons scattered among the stars. These stepping stones into forever softly speak our story. Oh, wondrous syllables, oh, unspeakable cadences, hear them echo in comfort across the spaces of my heart. We are like two solar empires, vibrant, pulsing roads into the impossibility of space. The silk of our roads is the lifeblood of civilizations, the knowledge of languages, the limits of understanding. Lying in the darkness, they trade the smooth, iron-fueled markings of love. See, with your eyes which are sabers, the planets embedded between the stars. These stepping stones into forever softly unfold our hymn. Oh, sonorous letters, oh, mellifluous stanzas, catch them echo in joy across the star charts of my mind. We are like two intergalactic councils, lively, silent beacons anchored in the impossibility of space. The bells of our prayer are the humming of commerce, the manuscripts of wisdom, the borders of empathy. Shining in the darkness, they exchange the intangible iron-fueled markings of love. See, with your eyes which are like a pair, the only truth which shall escape the hunger of black holes, shall outlast the burning of fusion stars, shall imbibe the sickness of forever engines, shall bind the passion of Terran empires, the stepping stones into forever. The stepping stones into forever. darkness, the stepping stones into forever. One word is too often profaned for me to profane it. One feeling too falsely disdained for thee to disdain it. One hope is too like despair for prudence to smother, and pity from thee more dear than that from another. I can give not what men call love, but wilt thou accept not the worship the heart lifts above and the heavens reject not? The desire of the moth for the star, of the night for the morrow, the devotion to something afar from the sphere of our sorrow. wears her boots one at a time, but she is also made of stars, and there is only so much contradiction a mind can take. However, I find that diving and swimming at the same time, an elixirous emotion that is both para and intradox, is both the banishment and the conjuration. She speaks alphabet one letter at a time, but she is also the effervescent mist, and there are only so many primal words my mind can speak. However, I find that dying and living at the same time, a panikeia of feeling that is both extra and sub-mense, is both the sending away and the beckoning. She puts her coat on one button at a time, but she is also the end and the beginning, and there are only so many cosmic eons my mind can traverse. However, I find that asphyxiating and breathing at the same time, a hybrid of mentality that is both inside and outside chronology, is both the unfolding and the locking of my heart. this is the part they rarely tell you about. The memory of solar dominance, of life never in one place, still ran in my deepest blood. Or so I was told. No one was still alive that had set foot in one of the fabled cruisers our people used to make, or that had gazed on stars from out of a body unchained by home gravity. And that was the part they rarely tell you about. Space travel operates on more than just three axes. Most of the journey, at least as far as the eye could tell, was full time. You stepped onto a ship and away from your life. That first step was the door hummed to a close behind you. That first step was a lifetime. I am a lantern awash in a storm, and he is flotsam that I found with me in a stream. How can I hold on to him when he is adrift just as I am, when he has nothing to hold on to himself? Humanity is a chain. It is one tissue which feeds itself, extremities upon extremities that somehow, in the midst of groping hunger, feed each other. And space travel was sold to us, the people of Episcopal, and a million other planets, like it was the great savior. The great release from the prison of community, the surgeon's knife that would incise into the common flesh and free the individual suffering. But to me, it is no such thing. This is space for me. An impossible ocean that separates me from the life I knew. A life I had thrown away, thinking it was too small. The irony is that at least the sailor on an endless ocean knows she has a goal, a beacon, a place to return to. I don't have even that. But if I'm truly honest, and on this, the eve of my arrival, I would like to be, I was always lost. My lost life wasn't that it was too small, it was that it was too big. And we dreamed, oh how we dreamed, and in dreaming we wounded ourselves every time we woke up to gaze on our bluish sun. A people of fools, of faint-hearted saps wilting in wax towers. Oh, so it seems to me now. But when I was there, still a child, the memories were the sweet taste of dripping honey, the faint buzz of a stomach that had gorged itself. Until the ships came. The beautiful blue moon-inscribed ships. I thought I could escape my hunger. But nothing makes you more hungry than the stars. Now, the ship had accelerated enough so that I could make out individual stars out there in the ocean. An ocean filled with stars, a deep heart for me to fill with starlight. The hunger is stronger than ever. The body beside me shifts and it has red hair, impossibly beautiful hair. In the corner of the room, I can hear my father's hushed whispers as he speaks of the monosaurs of the late Crusaders. The wish-wish sound of my mother's brush is his feet as she paints a purple scene of combination. Thus, the cliché is all too real. The hunger was inside me. Forget the human tapestry. Forget the organism which has no end, the body we call humanity. We are endless continuity, fragile repositories of liquid memory, songs, hope, fear, and most of all, longing. A longing for a home that isn't there anymore. A longing for a home that once was, but is now separated from us by an empty ocean. A longing for a home that we carry with us, and are thus incessantly reminded of its absence.